tonight, Philippine President Duterte drops out of the country's senatorial race.
The Philippine government postpones its mass COVID vaccination in the Visayas and Mindanao provinces as severe tropical storm Odette approaches.
Another former aide of ex-American President Trump faces contempt charges in connection with a deadly Capitol Hill riot.
And the United Kingdom records its first fatality due to the Omicron COVID variant.
Good evening. I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Tia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, twin twists in the Philippine election season. President Duterte and his longtime aide, Senator Christopher Bongo, officially withdraw their respective candidacies in the 2022 national elections. With Go now out of the presidential race, the administration is left with no standard bearer. Joyce Balancio has tonight's top story.
At first, it was a possible run for the vice presidency, which later became a bid for a Senate seat. But now, President Duterte won't be participating at all in the 2022 national elections. Duterte formally filed his statement of withdrawal before the Commission on Elections office Tuesday afternoon. Duterte's withdrawal took place hours after his own daughter, vice presidential aspirant and Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio, endorsed him in her Senate slate. This time around, there were no big crowds as Duterte made his withdrawal official. Journalists were also prevented from going near the president, so there wasn't any chance to ask him the reasons for dropping. Earlier in the day, President Duterte's preferred successor, longtime aide Senator Bongo, made good on his announcement to drop his presidential bid. Go said not even his party, Partido ng Pedralismo ng Dugong Dakilang Samahan or PDDS, knows that he will submit his withdrawal.
Wala pong nakakaalam. Sa totoo lang, ni driver ko po, hindi alam. Sumakay lang po ako ng taxi.
Go said he also wanted to show that he can be trusted with his words.
As a matter of principle, wala na po ako sa karerang ito sa pagtakbo bilang Pangulo ngayong 2022. Nakapagsalita na po ako last November 30. Inantay ko lang po ng konting panahon na ipaintindi po sa mga supporters ko na talagang nagre-resist po ang aking puso at ang aking isipan sa pagtakbo bilang Pangulo. At naawa po ako kay Pangulong Duterte. Matanda na po siya. Ayoko na po siyang pahirapan at ayaw rin po ng aking pamilya.
With this, the administration no longer have a standard bearer and there's no indication President Duterte is ready to endorse other bets.
Pag-uusapan pa namin ni Pangulong Duterte kung sino nga po yung makakapagpatuloy ng pagbabagong inumpisa ni Pangulong Duterte. Yung mga programang magaganda, build program. Yung mga programang nakakatulong po sa mga mahihirap po.
Presidential aspirant and Manila Mayor Isko Moreno says he understands it is a difficult decision for Go, but he hopes the senator will find peace.
I hope makita ni Senator Bong ang kanyang sarili. Dahil mahirap na decision yun. Malaking sakripisyo yun sa kanya. I hope he will find peace and hindi ko kasi alam kung ano ang pinaghuhugutan ni Senator Bongo.
Senator Manny Pacquiao, on the other hand, sees Go's withdrawal as a plus for his presidential bid.
Yun ang desisyon niya, so magpapasalamat naman tayo rin dahil at least kami Mindanaoan, isa na lang, no? Isa na lang ang kandidato ng taga Mindanao tayo. At ang politics naman is addition eh. Sa tingin ko, mas madaling makuha yung loob ng mga taga Mindanao dahil tayo lang ang taga Mindanao at sa Bisaya kandidato.
Labor leader Leodidy Guzman thinks the administration has a hidden agenda in letting Go drop out from the race.
Ang formal na pag-atras ni Bongo sa pagtakbo bilang presidente ay hudyat ng pagkakaisa ng pinaka-reaksyonaryong paksyon sa politika sa ating bansa. Ito ay naglalayon para kay Duterte na maiwasan ang asuntong isasampal laban sa kanya pagkatapos ng kanyang termino at isecure ang kayamanan at pampolitikang kapangyarihang naipon niya sa loob ng nakalipas na halos 6 taon niyang panunungkulan.
Vice Presidential aspirant and presidential daughter Mayor Sara Duterte said she respects the senator's decision.
Ang pag-file po ng candidacy at ang pag-withdrawal po ng candidacy is a personal decision. We can only support kung ano yung decision ng tao.
Joyce Balancho, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine leader's daughter, Vice Presidential aspirant Sara Duterte Carpio, expresses support for her father's exit from the senatorial race. Duterte Carpio says her father's withdrawal of his candidacy is a personal decision. The president dropped his senatorial bid shortly after his daughter endorsed it, along with those of other Senate bets. These include former Palace spokesman Harry Roque, former Senator Jinggoy Estrada, former Public Works Chief Mark Villar, former Defense Chief Gilbert Chodoro, former Quezon City Mayor Herbert Bautista, and Antique Representative Loren Legarda. President Duterte's withdrawal, hailed by the presidential tandem of Senator Panfilo Lacson and Senator Vicente Soto III, as a wise move. The campaign manager of presidential hopeful Francisco Esco Moreno Domagoso says he's a bit saddened by the president's move. Moreno earlier said he would vote Duterte for senator.
The Philippine Central Bank chief suspects an inside job in the recent cyber theft at one of the country's largest banks. An investigation is underway along with a process of reimbursing hundreds of BDO Unibank customers who lost money in the cyber attack. Juan de Guzman reports.
The Philippine Central Bank has created a special task force to investigate the unauthorized withdrawals affecting hundreds of BDO depositors. Central Bank Governor Benjamin Jokno has given it 30 days to finish the job, including finding out just how much was stolen and how many were affected. Jokno suspects the incident could be an inside job. He adds they will be carefully looking into both BDO and Union Bank, which was the bank used by the cyber criminals to funnel the money.
I'm sure may kasabot yan sa loob.
Sa loob, okay.
As given the extent of the hacking, maraming kasing kaso na sabay-sabay, di ba? So palagay ko mayroon yan sa inside. Pero we leave it to the two banks to investigate at kami rin nag-investigate.
One of the victims who lost 100,000 pesos or nearly $2,000 shares many of his fellow victims are struggling to get their money back, particularly with the reimbursement process of BDO.
Gagamitin daw po niya yun sa pang-tuition talaga ng anak niya. Ngayon hindi po niya alam kung saan niya kukuhanin ngayon yung ganung pera. Nananawagan din po kami na sana kung sa mapadali yung proseso ay mapabilis yung proseso, mapadali din po siya. Dahil ngayon po na work from home tayo, karamihan po sa mga nagtatrabaho na kagrupo po namin ay mga nasa kanilang probinsya, nahihirapan po na lumuwas para dun sa asikasuhin yung branch of yung dispute nila sa branch of account.
In BDO's latest statement on the incidents, the bank said it is processing the reimbursement of close to 700 affected clients. But they are appealing to the affected depositors to go to their branch of account to submit the proper documentation so that they may be refunded. It is still unclear how long the reimbursement process will take. Philippine Central Bank Director for Technology Risk and Innovation Supervision, Melchor Plabasan, is part of the task force. He says so far it looks like the cyber attack is an isolated case and only BDO and Union Bank were involved. He also confirmed BDO's earlier assertion that not all of the cyber attack victims will get their money back.
Innocent clients are those, as you mentioned, those who did not provide their credentials, who did not leak on any malicious. So those are considered innocent clients because there are also phishing victims who voluntarily provided credentials, who gave away their OTP to the let's say, to the customer, I mean, fake customer service. Online security is a shared responsibility, right? While we need to ensure that banks implement robust standards when it comes to protecting their infrastructure. Customers are also responsible in protecting their digital identity. The bank usually does not restitute clients who are called negligent.
The Cybercrime Division of the National Bureau of Investigation is still waiting for BDO and Union Bank to submit their accounting of the details of the weekend cyber attacks. The NBI is also appealing to the affected public to help speed up the process by revealing all relevant information so that the reimbursement process can move along swiftly. Warren De Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
The COVID-19 situation in all Philippine regions shows more signs of improvement. Health officials hope this can continue, even as the country braces for the possible entry of the Omicron variant. Rafael Bosano reports.
All regions in the Philippines are minimal risk in terms of COVID-19 cases. However, the health department is monitoring some areas like Region 5 and Region 12, where a positive one-week growth rate was observed, indicating a slight increase in recorded cases compared to the week prior. But overall, all island groups in the country are showing a plateauing trend in terms of cases. From 11,373 active cases as of December 11, DOH projections show this number could decrease further to 9,000 or as low as less than 2,000 by the end of January 2022. In the National Capital Region, the figure may be between 148 to 325 active cases, while in Calabar Zone, active cases may range from 397 to as high as 2,127 by the end of January. For the DOH Epidemiology Bureau, the public's adherence to health protocols will have a huge influence on their projections.
Kung dati, very conscious pa tayo, napansin ko yan sa mga restaurant, no? Dati, magtatanggal lang tayo ng mask kapag kakain, tapos ilalagay na natin ulit pagkatapos nating kumain. Ngayon, once we start eating, tapos kahit tapos na tayong kumain, hindi na naibabalik, no? Hanggang sa lumabas na tayo ng restaurant, no? So I think those are concrete scenarios of how we try to visualize a decline in MPHS compliance.
These projections also do not factor in the possible effect of the Omicron variant once it enters the country. The DOH asserts it is important to maintain low cases amid the Omicron threat, which, according to preliminary data, suggests is 10 times more transmissible than the original variant from Wuhan, China.
Sinasabi natin na Delta, posible siyang manghawa ng 6 to 8 cases, no? Pero pagdating sa Omicron, posibleng umabot ng 10 cases yung mahawaan niya. So what they're seeing is that from 6 to 8, now pwedeng umakyat ng 10 cases ang mahawaan, is a four-fold increase, no, in how transmissible this Omicron variant is. But again, these are initial findings. We really need to get more data, no, kung ganun ba talaga ka-transmissible.
So far, samples sequenced by the Philippine Genome Center have not yielded the presence of Omicron. Health authorities, however, stressed local governments must still be aggressive in locating potential cases, having them tested and isolated if necessary. Commercial establishments are also encouraged to do their part by strictly enforcing government protocols.
Whatever the effect of Omicron is upon its entry in the country, it may not be immediately felt. Pwede makita natin yan 2 to 4 weeks after the local entry of the Omicron variant in a country.
Currently, Omicron is present in 70 countries. The DOH hopes the country's improving COVID situation and easing restrictions will not lull the public to complacency, and that the hard lessons of the Delta surge will serve as a reminder the health threat is still here. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
Meanwhile, the Philippines records its lowest single-day tally of new COVID cases since May 23rd last year. The health department says 235 new COVID-19 infections were reported Tuesday. The country's active cases now down to 10,000 as 780 patients recovered. 10 deaths were reported. 8 laboratories were unable to submit data.
Philippine provinces in the path of an incoming storm have postponed the second round of a mass vaccination against COVID. Most of the areas that have had to reschedule are in the Visayas and Mindanao regions. The original schedule of December 15 to 17 is now moved to December 20th to the 22nd.
The target remains the same. Yung 7 million na target po natin para sa bayanihan bakunahan. But because of this tropical depression na minomonitor po natin, ay minabuti po natin na iurong muna, no? Yung magiging affected regions para yung affected provinces ay makapag-concentrate sa any quick response na kinakailangan pagdaan po nitong tropical depression na ito.
Severe tropical storm Odette bearing down on the Philippines' eastern Visayas and Caraga regions. The State Weather Bureau says Odette is now within the Philippine area of responsibility. Coastal residents of Surigao City are to be forcibly evacuated by Wednesday. Rescue teams in Agusan del Sur already preparing for any emergencies. The approach of the storm is a cause for much anxiety in Cagayan de Oro City. Dozens of residents there fear Odette might hit around December 16th, which marks 10 years since Super Typhoon Sandong devastated the area. Many of those who lost their homes to Sandong have yet to be given permanent shelter. Still to come, a magnitude 7.4 quake triggers panic in Indonesia.
The World Tonight returns after the break.
We're back on The World Tonight. An aide to former U.S. President Trump faces potential contempt charges from a congressional panel probing the 2020 Capitol Hill assault. Here's the full story.
We are here to address
the U.S. Congressional Committee investigating the January 6 Capitol attacks voted on Monday to seek contempt charges against Mark Meadows, the chief of staff to former President Donald Trump. The 7 Democratic and 2 Republican members of the House's Select Committee unanimously approved a report recommending criminal charges against Meadows, thus paving the way to a vote by the full chamber. Meadows, a former member of the House, has sued the committee, as well as Speaker Nancy Pelosi, over the matter. He's also repeatedly failed to appear for depositions before the panel. Republican Liz Cheney.
We believe Mr. Meadows is improperly asserting executive and other privileges, but this vote on contempt today relates principally to Mr. Meadows' refusal to testify about text messages and other communications that he admits are not privileged.
Meadows is believed to have received dozens of text messages during the January 6 riot when a mob of pro-Trump supporters stormed the Capitol, hoping to stop the formal certification of Trump's election defeat. Committee members also said they wanted to ask Meadows about his messages from members of Congress who were not named, discussing ways to avoid certifying the election result. Prior to the attack, Meadows is alleged to have stated in an email that the U.S. National Guard would, quote, protect pro-Trump people. 4 people died on the day of the riot, and 1 Capitol Police officer died the next day of injuries sustained while defending Congress.
The United Arab Emirates and Israel seek improved ties as the Gulf state hosts the first official visit there by an Israeli leader. The details in this report.
Israel's Prime Minister Naftali Bennett met with Abu Dhabi's Crown Prince Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed Al Nahyan on Monday in the UAE in what the Israelis are describing as a historic encounter, because it was the first ever public meeting between an Israeli leader and the UAE's de facto ruler. An honor guard welcome for Bennett as he met the UAE's foreign minister a day earlier. The trip is the latest push in Israel's recent attempt to strengthen its relationships with Muslim-majority neighbors in the region, an initiative led by the United States. Diplomatic ties between Israel and the UAE, for one, were only formalized last year. Trade between the two countries has skyrocketed in that period from about $125 million in 2020 to $500 million so far in 2021. Israel's ambassador to the UAE says the tricky issue of Iran, Israel's biggest rival, was one item on the agenda between the prime minister and crown prince. The UAE has actually been trying to improve its relationship with Iran, and Washington is expected to warn Emirati banks about breaking sanctions related to Iran this week.
In our global COVID updates, the world's first Omicron fatality recorded in the UK, and Germans protest stricter anti-COVID measures. This report has more details.
The COVID-19 Omicron variant claims its first known fatality in the United Kingdom. The victim died after contracting the highly transmissible variant. British Prime Minister Boris Johnson now urging people to get booster shots to prevent the variant from spreading further.
I think the idea that this is somehow a milder version of the virus, I think that's something we need to set on one side and just recognize the sheer pace at which it accelerates through the population. So the best thing we can all do is get our boosters. We're opening up centres across the country. We're getting in the army to help with the logistics.
Britain's health chief had said the Omicron variant now accounts for 44% of infections in London. China has detected its first case of the Omicron variant. State media reports the first case was found in the northern city of Tianjin, an individual who entered the country from an undisclosed overseas location. The patient is asymptomatic. Major Chinese manufacturing province Zhejiang is also fighting its first COVID-19 cluster this year, with tens of thousands of citizens in quarantine and virus-hit areas suspending business operations. In Germany, police clash with demonstrators protesting tighter restrictions to try to limit the spread of COVID-19. Germany is among the worst hit countries in Western Europe, with infection rates among school-aged children twice as high as the rate among other age groups. Earlier this month, the country implemented a ban on those who are unvaccinated from accessing all but the most essential businesses, such as grocery stores and pharmacies. Indonesia starts to give COVID-19 jabs to children aged between 6 to 11 years old on Tuesday. A senior health ministry official said Indonesia approved China's Sinovac biotech vaccine for the age group last month. More than 26 million children are being targeted for vaccination.
A magnitude 7.4 quake struck the eastern side of Indonesia Tuesday. The undersea tremor triggered tsunami warnings in at least five areas, but these were later lifted. Only minor damage was seen in the quake's aftermath. One person was reported hurt. Indonesia is still reeling from the eruption of Mount Semeru earlier this month, which killed at least 48 people.
The PSE index defies a mostly lower session in Asia as analysts take a more bullish stance on the Philippine economy's recovery prospects. Michelle Ong reports.
Major Asian markets dipped on Tuesday amid reports of Omicron variant spreading to more countries and ahead of looming policy decisions by the Federal Reserve and over a dozen others, including the BSP, this week. HSBC's Joseph Incalcaterra says the accelerated pace of Fed tapering has been largely priced in by the market already. He adds, the Philippines is now in a better position with the economy returning to a more familiar growth path, although with plenty of catching up to do.
The likes of the Philippines or Indonesia, they're in a better position than previous Fed tightening cycles. For one, that's because of external balances. The Philippines has been running a chronic on surplus this year, for example. That allows it to be a lot more resilient. On the other hand, inflation is slightly high in the Philippines, kind of edging ahead of the above the BSP's target. We think it will ease slightly into next year, which buys the BSP a little bit of flexibility. The degree of damage from 2020, like I said, that 10% GDP contraction, the Philippines does have a little bit more catching up to do than other countries in the region. I would say maybe the Philippines and Thailand are perhaps the two economies that saw the most damage from COVID. And as a result, there's the most to do in terms of catching up. And if you take something like FDI, for example, we look at FDI data and there's a pickup in debt FDI into the Philippines, but equity FDI, kind of the construction of new manufacturing facilities to basically take advantage of shifting supply chains, the Philippines has been falling behind on that front. And that's a very good, kind of good indicator for future long-term growth.
As for BlackRock Investments' Ben Powell, as the world economy enters a new market regime, global stocks will continue to deliver gains and bonds losses for a second year, a first since 1977. He adds new COVID strains will delay and not derail a powerful restart of economic activity as vaccination ramps up.
Hopefully, that's the future for the Phils over the next 6 to 12 months, is some version of that. And given, frankly, how cautious investors have been, for understandable reasons, right? Risks around the virus, some political concerns, uncertainty around the election, and all of that. One would hope if we project forward 6 months, we're through the election risk. Hopefully we've got an opening which is more progressed, and you'd like to see, therefore, that's kind of a big tailwind potentially for the Phils over the next 6 to 12 months. Let's see. So I would say in Asia overall, we are neutral Asia equities, but that's within this constructive equities framing that we have globally. And hopefully the Philippines can be geared into a couple of the points we've made around restarts, and again, the benefits of global policymakers, most importantly, the Fed, staying very supportive, we think, in the foreseeable future.
For the day, Philippine shares managed to book gains with the index closing above 7,200 level. Among the day's most actively traded stocks, Mondanisin, BDO, Metrobank, AC Energy, and PLDT. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Glennon Doyle Melton. Sometimes quitting is exactly the right thing to do. Quitting something that's not working requires self-awareness and courage.
And that is The World Tonight, the 14th of December, 2021. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!